Oh, it's nice to be home. I got God bumps all over me from that Derek Hinchcliffe and that song, I'll tell you. I like it when the practitioner of the day does his treatment and gets a standing ovation. That's got to be the right way to go. Well, we are so blessed today. We're so honored to have our guest speaker. I will tell you, in 1927, when Dr. Holmes wrote the Science of Mind text, he also began a magazine called Science of Mind magazine. And at that particular time, he did one more thing, and that is he created a World Ministry of Prayer. He created a prayer call line and a prayer group for the world that has been used and utilized ever since that time. And today we're very honored to have the manager of that particular auspicious committee to come forward and speak for us here after having come to do a practitioner seminar with our practitioners yesterday. And please do not miss the opportunity to go to his workshop this afternoon. Eugene Holden, who is our speaker today, comes from Agape. He's been 7 years at the head office managing the World Ministry of Prayer, and he is a friend of mine, and he is a beautiful soul and a beautiful man, and I loved sitting next to him down there with the energy that he was putting out. It was great. So please help me welcome Reverend Eugene Holden.
I was here already.
I knew you were there. I wanted to say all those nice things.
Thank you for coming. Have a good day. Good morning. Let me move this out of the way first. There. I'm in Kelowna. My goodness. I'm in Kelowna. Welcome from home office, greetings from home office, and also greetings from New Dawn Spiritual Center, which is a center that I attend in Aurora, Colorado. As we know, there's only one center, one church, but many, many, many locations. And I have the opportunity and the privilege of being here with you beautiful people on this Okanagan Day. How's that? Is that right? Yeah. I want to also say thank you to Drs. Deb and Drs. Ken for allowing me to be here today. I am just honored. The practitioners of the Centers for Spiritual Living, powerful people, powerful. The entire energy here is just absolutely incredible. And when I arrived on Thursday evening, I got a text from Dr. Ken asking me where I was, and I sent him, I left him a message and saying, you know, I'm here, and is it possible? I wonder if Dr. Ken, if it's possible, if I can work remotely and move to Kelowna, because it's just gorgeous here. So let's get started. Today's talk is about, it's arise, masters, arise. So I'm going to ask all the masters in the house to arise. See, only in Kelowna. See? Thank you, masters. Please have a seat. But now here's the thing. In order for you to arise as a master, you have to know that you're a master. Now, we are not talking about mastering over someone else. We don't want to be masters over anyone else, actually. Well, we can't, you know, no matter what the husbands think. You can't master your wife, so, yeah. Now, on the other side, wives may master their husbands. But what it is really about is about tapping into and mastering our own inner awareness, mastering our thoughts, mastering our emotions, mastering our feelings, right? Because we have to understand that we are surrounded by an infinite intelligence that we can use. And in becoming masters of how we think, how we feel, and how we behave, then allows us to be used by that intelligence. And so, one of the first things that we also want to do is to take a breath and to recognize. You know, especially when we are being pushed around by the winds of life. Because things happen, you know. And just things just happen. And so we need to be aware that when these things happen, not to get caught up with the winds of change, but to be masters of our own soul, so that no matter what the wind or where the wind may blow, that we are still centered in what we call spirit, that infinite intelligence that governs the universe, correct? Oh, but sometimes it's difficult. Oh, sometimes, you know, we just don't know that we're masters. And then we get mastered and we get bullied and we get pushed around by circumstances. But, you know, the thing is that we are not really pushed by circumstances. We are pushed by what we think about the circumstances. One of the things that I happen to come across in my short life here on this beautiful spiritual plane called Earth, is I had the opportunity to be in a restaurant watching parents with a small child. And you know these old saying, you know, don't cry over spilled milk. So I was watching this family, and the daughter, she was about 6 years old, and she spilled the milk. And the mother lost it. Lost it. And the poor child, she was just in so much, she was just, you know, really hurt by her mother just berating her for spilling the milk. Now the father was very, very calm about it. And he was, first he calmed his wife, and then he played with his daughter and made it, you know, such a fun game, and getting the napkins to pick up and to clean up the spilled milk. And so don't cry over spilled milk. And so what I came to realize in that moment, because my life, metaphorically, I had spilled the milk. Oh gosh, I had spilled the milk all over my life. And I was crying over the spilled milk. I was not yet a master. I was not yet the master of my thoughts. And it was my thoughts that had me going crazy. Until one day, until after that, I saw that, I began to think that, well, wait a minute. Because milk spills, stuff happens. Right? I'm in Kelowna. This is so cool. So in becoming a master, what we are called to do is first to recognize that we are not alone. To recognize that there is this infinite intelligence within us that not only is here to guide and direct us, but it also is that which breathes our breath. It is that which thinks our thoughts. It is that which beats our heart. It is that which, when we tap into it, guides us to being the master of our lives, and so that we can absolutely experience our greatest yet to be. But again, sometimes we forget that we are masters. There is a story in the New Testament that I love this story because it really illustrates how this particular individual didn't know he was a master until he was reminded. So I'm going to read the story first, and then we'll break it down some. This is, I can walk around with this because it's a small book. Thank you. So this is taken from the book of John, verse 5, blah, blah, blah. I know, right? Who cares? Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool which is called in Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down to a certain season, or in a certain season, into the pool and troubled the water. And whoever then first arrived in the troubled water, stepped into the troubled water, was made whole of whatsoever disease that they had. And a certain man was there. This is the guy we were speaking about. There's a certain man who was there which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been there for a long time in that case, he said to him, "Wilt thou be made whole?" The impotent man answered, "Master, Yes, but I have no man to help me into the water when the water is stirred. Then Jesus said to the man, rise up and take up thy bed and walk. So now let's break this down a little bit, and then we'll get into how this man became the master of his life. So metaphysically speaking, the five porches. So a porch is a covered structure that covers, you know, the house. And the house, metaphysically speaking, the house is your consciousness. And the five senses in the five porches basically indicate or symbolize the five senses of taste and sight and touch and smell and hearing. So sometimes people, not you, because I can see your aura, so not you, but sometimes there are people who just hang out in their senses, and the information that they get from their senses is the only thing that they go through life with, and never really going inside of the house into their consciousness. And at these five porches, as the story says, there were a lot of people lying around waiting for the waters to be stirred up. Waiting. How many of us in the room have been waiting for our ship to come in? How many of us have been waiting for that perfect relationship? How many of us have been, again, not you, but some of the people that you may know, but not you. How many of has been wait? How of us have been waiting for things to change? You know, sometimes, you know, I would wait. God, you know, I'll just sit here and wait on the Lord and just wait and just wait and just wait. And I was still waiting. But then what happens is that the ship goes by, the parade goes by, and we're still waiting. Still waiting. I heard a story from somebody. And this is where this woman, well, there was this flood, and the flood was calm coming up. And they were saying, you know, and as the flood began to rise into the house and above the house, and she climbed up to the roof of the house. And people were coming to her saying, you know, there was a person who came by in a rowboat and said, get in. And she's like, no, God is going to save me. I'm going to wait for God to save me. And the rowboat goes by. And then another rowboat comes by. Come on, get into the boat. The flood's going to come and sweep you away. I'm waiting for God to save me. Then a helicopter comes by and drops the ladder. Come on up. You're going to drown. The flood's coming up. No, I'm going to wait until God comes because God's going to save me. Well, the woman drowns and dies. She goes to heaven and she says, God, I was waiting for you to save me. And God says, I sent you two rowboats and a helicopter. What more do you need? So we want to not wait on anything at all, actually. Verse 4 goes into, for an angel of God went down at a certain time to stir up the water, and whoever went into the water first was healed of any disease. Well, see, now we have to understand that angels really are the messengers. And not so much with the wings, although the depiction of that is beautiful, but angels are the messages, or the messengers, or the messages that we get. Especially when we are sitting in the stillness, especially when we are just really opened and receptive to hearing whatever it is, the message that we're asking for. Messages show up in so many interesting places. Bumper stickers are a great place to catch a message. I was driving along in Southern California one day and saw this billboard, and it was from Bank of America. But the way they did this was in parts. So the first part said, you are more powerful. I'm like, now that's pretty cool. And then the next week it said, you are more powerful than you think. And again, that was during the time when my life was just in shambles. But the angel of God showed up in that billboard with that message, Eugene, you are more powerful than you think. And so angels or messengers come in so many different forms. In fact, I'm sure there are quite a few angels sitting next to you now. It's interesting where Dr. Holmes indicates in the textbook, healing and demonstration take place as our minds become attuned to the truth of being. There is no process of healing, but there is generally a process in healing. This process is the time and effort which we undergo in our realization of truth. So again, there isn't a process of healing because there's nothing to be healed. There's only that to be revealed. Only perfect health, wholeness, and well-being is to be revealed. Because remember, we are surrounded. I love the music today. Barbara, thank you so much. We are surrounded, and the music was talking about that, we are surrounded by this infinite intelligence that is here to do our bidding. It is here, and all that it knows how to do is say yes, no matter what we say to it. It's interesting to note, have you ever noticed when a person says, I am sick and tired? Well, the infinite intelligence that we call God just says yes, and that person is sick and tired. You watch them, you know, mope around. And so what we are to do, as Ernest Holmes talks about, is to change your thinking, change your life. So in this new thought, ancient wisdom teaching, another way that we hear that is you will be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So we have a new thought. We have a new thought about the way we live. We have a new thought about the way we think. We have a new thought about the way we feel. So far, so good? Here's the part that I love on the story. So there was a man. A man was there who had been sick for 38 years. So can you imagine being sick for a long time, for such a long, long time? Now here's the thing, is that sickness doesn't always mean a physical illness. How many people do you know who have maybe perhaps stayed in a job for 25 years that they just did not like? Or stuck in a marriage that they couldn't get out of, or they think that they can't get out of? See, the opposite of illness or sickness is wholeness and well-being. So when we are stuck in something that is not making us whole or having us not feel whole, then we are really ill. Not physically ill, but maybe emotionally and spiritually ill. So now, masters, tap into what is not working for them. And as we tap into what is not working for us as masters, and then we get to, again, change our thought and we get to change our lives. See, when we look at sickness as being opposite of the state of well-being and wholeness, we can start to see that many people live this kind of life, but not masters. So the story goes on to say that when Yeshua saw this man lying down and knew that he had been waiting for a long time, So this guy has been laying around for 38 years, hasn't bathed, so he must smell a little bit. So of course Yeshua knew that, whoa, what's wrong with this guy here? He sees this man and he says to the man, do you wish to be healed? Do you wish to be made whole? And the sick man answered, yes, my Lord, but I have no man when the water is stirred to put me into the pool, but when I am coming, others go in before me. Now here is the crux of the man's problem. He won't get off his big fat butts. Right? Sometimes we do this. I would love to play guitar, but I don't have the time. I would love to be in a wonderful relationship, but I'm scared. I would love to have a million, give you $1 million, but I need it for something else. So masters, as masters, we do not make excuses. We do not sit on that proverbial butt. I would love to learn how to ballroom dance, but I think I have two left feet. So I want you to think about this just for a moment. Where in your lives are you sitting on that butt? See, because we have to remember that we are surrounded by this infinite intelligence that knows only how to say yes. So when I say to this infinite intelligence, I would love to learn how to play guitar, but I don't have enough time, the infinite intelligence says, yes, Eugene, you don't have enough time, so you won't learn how to play. Masters, as masters, we do not make any excuses at all. We get to get off that butt and say, I'm going to do this. Because I am surrounded by this and supported by this infinite power that only knows how to say yes to my words. It is such a wonderful gift to stand in the position of going, you know what? I can do anything. I can do anything because I am supported. I am the beloved of the beloved. I am God's gift. In a different way, you know how you used to hear, you know, you think you're God's gift to the world. I'm going to say, Master, say yes. You are God's gift to the world. Yes. Let me try this again. You are God's gift to the world.
Yes.
Amen. See, because the world, which is the world that you inhabit, you know, not just the earth, the entire earth, but the world of your home, your job, your school. And you are God's gift wherever you go. You are God's gift wherever you go. See, you are the light. You are the brilliant illumination of pure spirit. So do not allow, because masters do not, allow ourselves in our butts to keep us from shining the light. Oh man, the world is hungry for you. The world is waiting for you to shine your light. So again, Yeshua says to the man, would you like to be healed? And he says, yes, but we don't make excuses as masters. So I want us all today to set the intention to give up excuses. Oh, but Eugene, I'm scared. You catch that one? Oh, Eugene, but I'm scared. Okay. So what? Because what I have recognized in doing all the prayer work that I've been doing throughout the years is that, and I still get, you know, fear still comes up for me, but I've intended and I affirm that I am a master and that fear will not stop me because I know that on the other side of the fear is just this panoramic view of infinite possibilities, which is what the workshop is about today. Insert shameless plug. But it really is about tapping into those buts. You know, why am I not doing this? What keeps me from living my desire when God and Spirit and the infinite intelligence, all it wants to do is to live through me and to shine through me? How can I serve today, sweet Spirit? How can I serve today, oh Lord? So the infinite intelligence is waiting for us, masters, to let go of all the fear. There's nothing to be afraid of. So when that egoic mind, that small r reality starts to show up, being masters, we get to say, ah, no, I'm not going there. I'm not doing it because I have a life to live. Every one of us has a life to live, and that life that we are to live is a life of infinite possibilities. It's a life of infinite joy. It's a life of infinite abundance. I would love to have more prosperity, but no, stop the buts. What I love about nature is a wonderful, wonderful example of how abundant we are. Cannot take one pine tree. You cannot count the single needles on the pine tree. It is so abundant. The stars in the sky, you can't count the numbers of stars in the sky. The universe is so abundant in us being created in the spiritual image and after the likeness of the divine are so much more abundant than even that. So as masters, we get to go through life in such a joyous way. You know who are great masters? You know who are wonderful masters to watch? Little kids. Oh, man. You know what else I like about children? Is they are always in the moment called now. Right here, right now. I was out watching some kids play. And mom and dad were out there. And mom says to the four-year-old kid, we're going to be leaving in about 5 minutes. Child is four. What's a minute? Right? Because kids are always in the now. So masters, we are always in the moment of now. But what happens with our egoic mind, sometimes what happens is that we get drawn into the past. And the past draws us and then we get all discombobulated. I wonder if that's in the dictionary. But what happens is we allow ourselves to get drawn in the past. Remember what happened? So I'm not going to do that again. But masters, we don't make any excuses. So let me go on with the rest of the story. Then Yeshua says to the man, get up, pick up thy bed and walk. So, masters. Now a bed is the foundation. So we have the foundation of joy. Pick up your bed of joy and let's walk. The bed of prosperity. Pick up the bed of prosperity and walk. And then the story goes on to say, and the man was immediately healed. See, when the Christ consciousness from within us, and when we say yes to that, we are immediately healed from the inside out. And so, knowing that all is well, knowing that each and every one of us in this room shine with such a brilliance and that we are absolutely in tune with that which absolutely just drives us and impels us and propels us to be our greatest yet to be, then we become masters in such a way that just our very presence assists in awakening humanity to its spiritual magnificence, wherein then we are a part of creating a world that works for everyone because we said, yes, I am a master of my life. So in closing, I encourage, as we started, all of the masters in the house, arise, master, arise. And let's pick up our bed and walk. No, truly, arise, masters, arise. Arise and say yes to your life. Say yes to whatever it is that you are desiring to experience. Say, I am a master of my life. I am a master of my life. There is nothing that can stop me. There is nothing that can stop me. Kelowna, thank you so very much. Peace and blessings.